In days of September and October, as a young child in Catholic school, on Friday we were finished with school a little early, and so there was still time for class, so we could ask Sister any questions. Sister, if you would, tell us about heaven. And we would listen very anxiously for everything she said about heaven. It was nice to hear about heaven, and that someday, pray God, we would be there, enjoying for all eternity. But on occasion, she would also say, I have to tell you about hell. We hated to hear about that. It was never pleasant. It was like maybe I could distract myself with other thoughts, but we still heard her words. Frightening. This reading, this gospel and the epistle about abundance and how much we have to look forward to. Just pure abundance, but not more cars and more computers and iPads, but more love, more joy, more family closeness than we could ever imagine with God for all eternity. It's going to be marvelous. And it's nice as a priest when I come across people, oftentimes at the hospital, sometimes those who are dying, but I think to myself, I will see you in heaven someday. It's exciting. It's very, very exciting. But not today, Lord. You know, we don't want to rush things, right? We also celebrate the 100th anniversary of the culmination of the visions of Our Lady at Fatima. Three young children, simple children, not well-educated children, from a very small country, very small, Portugal, not really even involved in World War I when Our Lady first appeared May 13, 1917. And so the children, they're praying their rosary, but like children, Hail Mary, 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 Hail Mary. One decade's done, let's move on to number two. To play is a great motivator, not just for us grown-ups, for children. We like to play, and they do too. But Our Lady appeared to them. And the first words out of Lucy's mouth is, young Lucy, the oldest of the three, what do you want of me? Sort of fascinating. What do you want of me? And the lady said, I want you to come back here on the 13th next month. And I want you to pray the rosary. Well, that makes sense. The children grew up with that. They knew to say their prayers. So that was not difficult to pray the rosary. She didn't say, slow it down. She just said, pray the rosary. Lucy describes Mary as like crystal and light resplendent through that crystal. There was such a peace in her and her two cousins' hearts, Francisco and Jacinta. And they return. And now they're being persecuted for saying that they saw this beautiful lady. The lady did not say who she was. Other people presumed that it was the Blessed Mother, but the children did not presume. And so Mary continues to talk, and she says of the two younger ones, are they willing to suffer for my son? Imagine asking little children, are you willing to suffer? I don't even know when they said yes, I don't know what kind of suffering is she talking about? But they said yes. And Mary said, you will suffer. And they did. There were three secrets. Ooh, we love a secret. Ooh, especially if we're the ones who know the secret and no one else does. Three secrets. One was a vision of hell. We don't like thinking about hell. We don't like talking about hell. And these beautiful children, they do not want to see a vision of hell, but that's what Mary shows them. And first, in that vision of hell, and Lucy describes it somewhat like a river of fire with these spirits coming out of the fire and groaning with animal sounds. And in that vision of hell, what was so frightening was the knowledge the children had. There was an absence of God. God was not in that vision. God is not in hell. And then they saw the spirits over and over and over again, constantly repeating, why did I do that? Why did I do that? Why did I do that? And then there was the knowledge that this wasn't for a million years. This was eternal. This was forever. Then they saw a vision of Satan. Fortunate for them, certainly by a grace from God, they did not die witnessing that. They felt some comfort with the lady right there. But she wanted to show them that hell is real. And that hell is a place we don't belong. We should not desire to want to be at such a painful place. But you know, Satan is the great deceiver. I am your friend. I will give you whatever you want. Whatever you're hungry for, I will give that to you. I will give you happiness. But for many of us, that doesn't work. So he's the great accuser. You, steeped in your sinfulness, how do you think God could ever forgive you for all your sins? Constantly accusing us. And for some, losing hope that God would forgive us. That no matter what sin we commit, or how many, that with contrition, with sorrow for our sin, God will forgive us. The second secret. Mary said to Lucy that World War I would end. Is there a war? The children were not aware of any wars, but she said World War I would end. But pray, 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 pray for peace. Pray the rosary. Pray for peace. She said, because if not, there will be a far greater war under the time of Pope Pius the 11th. Be a far greater war, and the church must dedicate Russia to my Immaculate Heart. The children had no idea whatsoever of what was going on in Russia at this time, that the Tsar was overthrown and that Marxism was to take hold and affect people for up to this time. The children had no idea of that. But our Blessed Lady asked them to consecrate Russia to her Immaculate Heart. Then the third secret. And that's the secret I heard of all the time in school. And even us children would say, what's the secret? What's the secret? Oh my gosh. Because no one knew the secret except the Pope. Or at least it was folded up and written out and given to the Pope. It's like, does it predict the end of the world? Some calamity? And of course, it makes for great movies. And only Ron Howard could direct an incredible movie with The Third Secret, starring Tom Hanks, you know? And we're all just riveted like, oh my gosh. And we're like listening to them as if it's scripture. I don't understand that. But nonetheless, you know, I guess we like good movies. And we trust in directors. They have to be telling the truth. Why? They're from Hollywood. Anyways. The third secret. And so much had been talked about the third secret that finally Cardinal Ratzinger, later to be Pope Benedict, Cardinal Ratzinger sort of wrote a dissertation about the secret. And he said that the secret was more in visionary form, very similar to the book of Revelation. And like the book of Revelation, we cannot read it literally. People try to. Again, it makes great movies. But it was not the intention of the book of Revelation, or this third secret, to be written so literal. But in the secret, it is a little fascinating that one of the visions is of a bishop dressed in all white, going up a ladder, and then being murdered and then falling to his knees. Kind of strange. What bishop would that be? When Pope John Paul was the intended assassination attempt on his life, there was a Muslim, Muhammad Ali Aka, a professional assassin. That's the way he describes himself. He is a professional assassin. He knows what he's doing. And he shoots Pope John Paul out in the square at St. Peter's. Pope John Paul is rushed to the hospital. And weeks later, in his recovery, he asked his secretary, now Cardinal Divich, who is retired from Warsaw, Poland, he asked his secretary, bring me the documents, the third secret. I'm going to read that. And so two documents are brought, the actual writings of St. Lucy, and a translation of that. So he read the two. And he said, you know, I think I'm the bishop in white. I'm the one the vision is describing. But isn't it strange? In the vision, well, I mean, I'm not dead. I'm alive. Like a good Christian, Pope John Paul forgave the assassin. Remember, he has to, right? He wants to go to heaven like us, right? You can't have that on your heart, like, I want him murdered. I want him to suffer, Lord. I want him to suffer. That's not going to get us to heaven. John Paul knows that better than any of us. He's a great saint. And so he goes to visit Muhammad Ali Aka in prison. And he brings with him his secretary. And so his secretary shares a lot of this. And this young man is sort of astounded at, even though he's been slowed down, right? He's astounded at his robustness. I am not sorry that I attempted to kill you. I am sorry you did not die. Now imagine, you're forgiving the person, and they're still saying, I'm sorry you didn't die. Oh my gosh. You know, you'd almost feel like all of hell is surrounding you. And Cardinal Divich is listening to this. And I don't understand. I am a professional assassin. And that bullet was directed at your heart. You should be dead. But I'm afraid that a power far greater than myself directed that bullet. And Pope John Paul said, Our Lady of Fatima. He misunderstood. And he said, Ah, the daughter of Muhammad tried to protect you? No. The Virgin at Fatima, the mother of our Savior Jesus Christ, protected me from that bullet. I think what's sort of amazing about all that is the fact that, again, we have many evidences of this in Scripture, but again, in this third secret, the vision of the Lucy and the children, the secret, of a man in white, presumably a pope, being assassinated and dying. But isn't it fascinating that, as Pope John Paul said, but I'm not dead. I didn't die. So maybe the secret's false. But it gives us an idea that through our praying, we can change history. Like Scripture, Lord, if there's just 10 good people in Nineveh, will you spare the city? Lord, forgive me for pursuing this. But if there's only 5 good people in Nineveh, will you spare the city? If there's 5 good people, I will spare the city and not cast the harm that I had planned. It shows us in many ways, and we should continue reading Scripture, that there are many instances where through our prayers, our sincerity, our desire to turn to God in sorrow for our sinfulness, that the course of events of life will change. Something, I will never be able to change. I can never stop doing this. I can never get over this. That's not true. Alone, oh, you're right. Alone, you're right. But there is nothing we cannot overcome or change with the power of prayer. And Our Lady asks us, just pray to my son. Pray to him. Pray to him. Amazing, an assassin. Why are you not dead? We know why. We know why. Let us stand and pray.